This is the first purpose-built museum that has been built in London in the last 40 years. This 500-year-old house, which was once the home of the grandson of Lord Nelson and Lady Hamilton, fell into disrepair, but it was restored by the Pinner Association. The grounds of the house are now Pinner Memorial Park. The museum, dedicated to William Heath Robinson, has been built here. Harrow filmmakers were there to record the opening. We interviewed the key people involved with the museum. And through the interviews, you will hear the story of the museum opening and plans for the future. Alan Colegrave ensured we had good sound for the interviews and speeches and is seen here hiding behind the speakers.
Hello, Cynthia Wells, Acting Chair of the West House and Heath Robinson Museum Trust. This must be a great day for you.
It's absolutely amazing. I can't really believe that it's happening. 25 years in the planning this has been, really.
What difference has it made having the museum in the park, in Pinner Memorial Park?
I think it's a great opportunity for the museum because obviously you've got lots of families who come to the park, so they can see that the museum is there and they'll want to come in and interact. I also think that it's very useful for the cafe, and think that they've then got something to do if it rains. So it's sort of a full day out. You can go and play outside in the park. You can also come inside. There's all sorts of activities.
Hello, David Chittleborough. This is an exciting morning for us all, but particularly maybe for you after your involvement in actually getting the museum built. Which particular contractors have been involved in the building of the museum?
Well, the architect, who's the main consultant, is ZMMA. The contractor, Filium, are a local contractor. And if the architect wants to change element of design, they've been happy to deal with that as best as possible. So we're into a happy situation where we've got a claims-free project. Mm-hmm. The museum itself is built on piles. We've had a piling contractor, we've had a concrete frame contractor, we've had the superstructure contractor, which is a cross-laminated timber frame. We've had the roofing subcontractors, the glazing. We've a very important contractor dealing with the mechanical and electrical fit out. They're also responsible for the maintenance of the West House at the moment.
What are your hopes for the museum over the next year or two?
I hope it becomes self-sufficient, and I hope it attracts the numbers that we expected it would attract.
And what role do you think the town of Pinner, the restaurants, the cafes, the shops, can also play?
One of our dreams was that we would increase the footfall in Pinner, and we shall have leaflets telling them that they better also go to Pinner and look at our medieval high street.
How many years has it been in the making, as it were?
We met in 2002. Okay. The reason why we approached Pinner was because, of course, William Heath Robinson spent many of his formative years here in Pinner, in Moss Lane.
Tell us a bit about your own relationship with William Heath Robinson.
Well, it obviously goes back to pretty much birth, really. He was my great uncle. He died the same year I was born, in 44. And, I've been brought up with him. Their pictures have been hanging on the walls. I still have many of those pictures hanging on my walls. They mix together very much the families. So the knowledge of Will, the humour of Will, the family gatherings which took place regularly throughout his lifetime was very, very much part of our fabric, if you like, yes. There's a relation, but also more so as just a respecter of his work. I think this is very important work indeed, both on an artistic level, on a humorous level. Looking at his work, both the humorous work and his serious artistic work, this is a man who's deeply human, was deeply concerned and interested and insightful in the way we behave. Today, more than ever, I would say, we can learn so much, both adults and children. And if that all takes place, I'll be delighted.
Can you name some particular schools or universities that you've been working with already?
Yes, we've worked with St Helena School, also in Northwood, who have actually produced the machine which today will be used to cut the ribbon. What I think they'll find very exciting when they actually come here is to be working in the activity studio, which is the part of the building with the glass doors facing onto the park itself. So that should be a very attractive place for the youngsters to work in. We're almost, if you like, an arts centre.
We're very excited to be finally opening, and it's looking lovely. Very, very pleased with the final result.
What are you most looking forward to doing with the children in particular?
I think it's very important to get the whole ethos of Heath Robinson across. So not just his work, but how he saw the world and how he interacted with his children. He really believed in learning in a very informal and fun and imaginative way. And that's what we believe as well, because we think that, you know, schools sometimes have lost a bit of that because they're so pushed towards results.
Mm-hmm. Essentially, you're appealing to children of all ages, or are you specialising in a particular age group?
So yes, we're really going from sort of 0 to 25 and all the adults who like to be childish too.
What are you planning to do today in the activity studio?
Today we're going to be doing a number of different things in the activity studio. But the main thing is we've got a giant 2.5 metre by 2.5 metre canvas, which has a line drawing of one of his characters from a children's book, Uncle Lubin, drawn on it. And the children will be sticking bits of coloured textiles on and trying to match the colours in the original print. And then hopefully we'll put that on display somewhere. And we also have a famous illustrator, Robert Duncan, coming, who's going to be demonstrating drawing, which will be going on the big screen. And I've also got Michael Rosen in there, who's going to do book signings.
What's your expectation of today?
Well, I hope as many people as possible will come, who will really enjoy what we're doing today, who will enjoy hearing Michael Rosen and Stuart Hobley from the Heritage Lottery Fund and the Mayor of Harrow, because Harrow Council's support has been really important to us. And I hope they'll enjoy the entertainment and visit the museum, because the lucky few who get in today will receive a golden ticket, which we hope they'll keep as a memento of the occasion.
What have been the marketing challenges so far?
The main marketing challenges, I would say, is getting out the message about Heath Robinson. Mm-hmm. Many of us know Heath Robinson. We know that the words have entered the language as something tied together with bits of string and with a few cogs and nuts and bolts. But knowing the full breadth of his genius, that's what we need to get across. Not many people know that he was also a landscape painter, an illustrator, and he was an enormously talented draftsman, and that's really what we want people to know.
There's a very interesting logo for the museum, the mixture of the letters. How did you arrive at that?
We wanted something very Heath Robinson. We wanted something quirky and different, but also modern.
What would you say the key messages that you'd like to get out to the world about the opening of this museum and what it represents?
Come and see it. Come and discover Heath Robinson. I bet you will find something you never knew about Heath Robinson if you come here.
Where did your interest in William Heath Robinson start?
Well, when I was at school, art was the best of my A-levels, but we didn't have much money, so I actually took a degree in physics at university. And shortly afterwards, in 1971, I think it was, I had an interest already in book illustration, came across Heath Robinson's Hans Andersen drawings. And the pen and ink drawings in particular were so fine, they just made the hairs on the back of my neck stand up. And I wanted to find out more about this wonderful artist. Started collecting his work, and I wrote an article for a magazine about his early black and white work, which was little known at the time. And as a result of that, I was then asked by a publisher to turn it into a book on his illustrations. So I wrote a book on his serious work.
And what was that book called?
It was called The Illustrations of William Heath Robinson, and it came out in 1982.
Mm-hmm. What other books have you written since?
Oh, well, I suppose the most important one was the book that went with the Dulwich Picture Gallery exhibition, which was called The Art of William Heath Robinson. But I've also put together collections of his humorous work for Duckworth's.
I know the first special exhibition is Heath Robinson at War. Which other ones are you planning? I believe they're going to change every 3 months.
The next exhibition will be the Brothers Robinson. William had two brothers, Charles and Tom, who were also illustrators. And so we're trying to show how they worked and how they collaborated in their early careers and then diverged onto different paths later on. Give people a chance to see more of the illustration work than this present exhibition does.
Hello, Judith Elliott, retail manager of the museum. What are you particularly excited about in terms of what the shop has to offer?
The really exciting thing is that to make things quite different, not only Heath Robinson, but we have got the maker's art. Different artists, artisans will come in, and we have got lovely jewellery, pottery, ceramics and glassware. It is fantastic.
So my very first thought is congratulations, or in the language of my parents, to keep the diversity going, mazel tov. But it is simply wonderful that it has happened. My connection with this, as you heard, I was brought up in Pinner, 6A Love Lane. Do go and go to the shrine of 6A Love Lane. So I walked past this house to and fro every day, played cricket just over there. And I have another connection with Heath Robinson, which those of you who have seen the little film that we made for BBC, I have a broken front tooth, and the reason why I have a broken front tooth is that we used to make Heath Robinson go-karts. Me and my friend, we came down Moss Lane, and just where it turns into Moss Close, on our go-kart, it turned over and over and over, and basically I crashed the go-kart because I was steering. Brian was much better than me, and I smashed my front tooth just outside Heath Robinson's house. And the other way was that my brother, who entertained me in our bedroom was a kind of theatre for my brother's benefit, he would like put on shows, he read me the whole of the Professor Brainstorm books. And of course these are beautifully and wonderfully illustrated by Heath Robinson. The number of times we looked at the burglar catching machine and nearly peeing ourselves with laughter, absolutely delighting and loving the Heath Robinson drawings. Heath Robinson was someone who documented an era. He showed the mentality of people by gently poking fun at it, but it's wonderful that there is a special place dedicated entirely to Heath Robinson's work. So I am over the moon for about 10 different reasons. Right, now to the machine.
The contraption, with some ingenious engineering, was built by girls from the Heath Robinson Club at St Helen's School, Northwood.
For those of you who can't see, the clock is turning and there's chains at the bottom which are spinning round now. And there's a bell that's ding-a-linging. And I can't actually see the ribbon, but I'm sure it's there. There, another ding. Oh, it's got a tune. And a ball has dropped. Another ding. And the ball goes down into a bottle, which drops.